Hello, students. This is Mrs. Lee. I will be reading for you The Devil and Daniel Webster, Part 3. If you remember, when we ended Part 2, Jeb Stone was quite desperate, and the only person he could think who could save him from the devil was Daniel Webster. He jumps in his wagon, and he goes on a journey to find Daniel Webster and see if he will help argue for the rights to his soul. While we're reading Part 3, please pay attention to the great use of vocabulary, fantastic figurative language. I also want you to pay attention to the encounters with Daniel Webster and the devil. The dialogue between the two is quite interesting. We will begin with The Devil and Daniel Webster, Part 3. It was early in the morning when he got to Marshfield, but Daniel was up already, talking Latin to the farmhands and wrestling with the ram Goliath, and trying out a new trotter and working up speeches to make against John C. Calhoun. But when he heard a New Hampshire man had come to see him, he dropped everything else he was doing, for that was Daniel's way. He gave Jeb Stone a breakfast that five men couldn't eat, went into the living history of every man and woman in Cross Corners, and finally asked him how he could serve him. Jeb Stone allowed that it was a kind of mortgage case. "Well, I haven't pleaded a mortgage case in a long time, and I don't generally plead now, except before the Supreme Court," said Daniel. "But if I can, I'll help you." "Then I've got hope for the first time in 10 years, said Jeb Stone, and told him the details. Daniel walked up and down as he listened, hands behind his back, now and then asking a question, now and then plunging his eyes at the floor as if they'd bore through it like gimlets, and gimlets is a tool for making holes. When Jeb Stone had finished, Daniel puffed out his cheeks and blew. Then he turned to Jeb Stone, and a smile broke over his face like the sunrise over Monadnock. "You've certainly given yourself the devil's own row to hoe, Neighbor Stone," he said. "But I'll take your case."
"You'll take it?" said Jeb Stone, hardly daring to believe.
"Yes," said Daniel Webster. "I've got about 75 other things to do and the Missouri Compromise to straighten out. But I'll take your case, for if two New Hampshiremen aren't a match for the devil, we might as well give the country back to the Indians." Then he shook Jeb Stone by the hand and said, "Did you come down here in a hurry?"
"Well, I admit I made time," said Jeb Stone.
"You'll go back faster," said Daniel Webster, and he told him to hitch up Constitution and Constellation to the carriage. They were match grays with one white forefoot, and they stepped like greased lightning. Well, I won't describe how excited and pleased the Holstone family was to have the great Daniel Webster for a guest. When they finally got there, Jeb Stone had lost his hat on the way, blown off when they overtook a wind, but he didn't take much account of that. But after supper, he sent the family off to bed, for he had most particular business with Mr. Webster. Mr. Stone wanted them to sit in the front parlor, but Daniel Webster knew front parlors and said he preferred the kitchen. So it was there they sat, waiting for the stranger, with a jug on the table between them and a bright fire on the hearth, the stranger being scheduled to show up on the stroke of midnight, according to specification. Well, most men wouldn't have asked for better company than Daniel Webster and a jug. But with every tick of the clock, Jeb Stone got sadder and sadder. His eyes rove round. And though he sampled the jug, you could see he couldn't taste it. Finally, on the stroke of 11:30, he reached over and grabbed Daniel Webster by the arm. "Mr. Webster, Mr. Webster," he said, and his voice was shaking with fear and a desperate courage. "For God's sake, Mr. Webster, harness your horses, and get out away from this place while you can.
You've brought me a long way, neighbor, to tell me you don't like my company, said Daniel Webster, quite peaceable, pulling at the jug.
Miserable wretch that I am, groaned Jabez Stone, I've brought you a devilish way, and now I see my folly, and folly means his mistake. Let him take me if he wills. I don't hanker after it, I must say, but I can stand it. But you're the Union's stay and New Hampshire's pride. He mustn't get you, Mr. Webster. He mustn't get you.
Daniel Webster looked at the distracted man, all gray and shaking in the firelight, and laid a hand on his shoulder.
I'm obliged to you, Neighbor Stone, he said gently.
It's kindly thought of, but there's a jug on the table and a case in hand, and I never left a jug or a case half finished in my life. And just at that moment, there was a sharp rap on the door.
Ah, said Daniel Webster very coolly.
I thought your clock was a trifle slow, Neighbor Stone. He stepped to the door and opened it.
Come in, he said.
The stranger came in, very dark and tall. He looked in the firelight. He was carrying a box under his arm, a black Japan box with little air holes in the lid.
Reminds me of his neighbor.
At the sight of the box, Jabez Stone gave a low cry and shrank into a corner of the room.
Mr. Webster, I presume, said the stranger, very polite, but with his eyes glowing like a fox's deep in the woods.
Attorney of record for Jabez Stone, said Daniel Webster, but his eyes were glowing too.
Might I ask your name?
I've gone by a good many, said the stranger carelessly. Perhaps Scratch will do for the evening. I'm often called that in these regions. Then he sat down at the table and poured himself a drink from the jug. The liquor was cold in the jug, but it came steaming into the glass.
And now, said the stranger, smiling and showing his teeth,
I shall call upon you, as a law-abiding citizen, to assist me in taking possession of my property.
Well, with that, the argument began, and it went hot and heavy. At first, Jabez Stone had a flicker of hope, but when he saw Daniel Webster being forced back at point after point, he just sat scrunched in his corner with his eyes on that Japan box. For there wasn't any doubt as to the deed or the signature. That was the worst of it. Daniel Webster twisted and turned and thumped his fist on the table. But he couldn't get away from that. He offered to compromise the case. The stranger wouldn't hear of it. He pointed out the property had increased in value, and state senators ought to be worth more. The stranger stuck the letter of the law. The stranger stuck to the letter of the law. He was a great lawyer, Daniel Webster, but we know who's the king of lawyers, as the good book tells us. And it seemed as if, for the first time, Daniel Webster had met his match. Finally, the stranger yawned a little. Your spirited efforts on behalf of your client do you credit, Mr. Webster, he said. But if you have no more arguments to adduce, I'm rather pressed for time. And Jabez Stone shuddered.